My name is Eva Venari. Welcome to the show, and I'm founder of the Elevate Institute. I will be your host for today's podcast. When doctors say we don't know is an inclusive conversation, and so many are craving to share their stories and experiences, today's guest is no exception. Today's honored guest is Carrie Cardozo. Carrie, known as the business psychic, started her business 6 years ago after having her job running a multimillionaire, leaving her job running a multimillionaire dollar company, and she works with established entrepreneurs and businesses to guide them to reach new levels of impact, success, and profit while staying true to who they are and the purpose they are here to share in the world. Carrie, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm excited to be here for this conversation today.
Yeah, I thank you for raising your hand to be a part of it, because there are so many people experiencing this very private curiosity. I went to the doctor and I asked them for some help, and my answer in reply, instead of "you have this, this is what you need to do," was, "well, we don't really know." Yeah. So you've been faced with this?
I have. I've been faced with it a couple times in my life, actually. When I was my freshman year of college, actually, was the very first time I started having really, really bad migraines, to the point where I couldn't even sit in class. And I went from doctor to doctor. They had me cut my hair because it was super long. What? And I thought maybe it was heavy. Yeah,
oh,
like we cut my hair.
Okay.
I had my wisdom teeth taken out. Everything you could think of, I got taken off of birth control pills. They could not find, I had MRIs and CAT scans. They could not find a single reason why I was having such debilitating migraines. And I had never had them before in my life, ever. And looking back now, it was really that I was out of alignment with what I was doing. I didn't want to be there. I didn't want to be studying what I was studying. I was so frustrated in my life at that time. But they like couldn't figure it out for me. And it was really frustrating being 19 years old, trying to study, and literally not being able to like open my eyes at times because it was so bad, so bad.
19 years old and already having daily migraines? Is that what I heard?
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. It was like daily migraines. Yeah. Yep.
So this is interesting. Just you're tickling a memory of my own. I used to get the daily migraines, and not to make it about me, but I'm moving it into this idea that I found a migraine study at about 25, something like that. It's been a while. And I called them up and I says, "Hey, I'm getting these migraines." And they asked me a few questions and said, "Yes, the migraine is the light sensitivity. It's the feeling like you're sick in your stomach, and it's just a overall aching. You can't ever get relief from it. You're all of the associated symptoms." And they said, "Well, how often do you have them?" And I said, "Daily." And their response was, "Oh, that's not a migraine. We don't know what you have." And he hung up on me.
Wow.
So I'm interested to know, how did these individuals, they didn't have a comment on the definition of migraine.
Yeah, well, it was interesting because no, they didn't. They my doctor pushed to have like all these tests. And like I said, I had like my thyroid tested. I had so many blood tests done that they had a hard time trying to find my veins. Like they created huge scars, like where you put an IV in. And I'll tell you what, like they never had a solution to it, but what actually stopped my migraines, which I guess is crazy. And I would have optical migraines. So I would lose my peripheral vision, and then I would lose my vision straight on. I could only see out of my peripheral, and then I would get slammed with a headache. So it was very hard to like read, take notes, like look at the board in class, whatever it was I was doing. But I ended up getting pregnant because they took me off my birth control pills. I got pregnant like the next month, and had my daughter, who is now 20. And I stopped getting them the minute I got pregnant. Literally just stopped getting the migraines. We never, like nothing ever moved forward from that, ever. And I never got them again, But I did a lot of changing of stuff in my life. After I like went, well, obviously, you know, I was 19 and now
well,
I'm pregnant.
Now you've got a baby. Right. Yeah. That's a life-changing event for sure.
But I started like, you know, before that, it just felt like everybody decided for me what I was going to do. Like for high school, my parents decided I was going to a private school. And then when I applied for colleges, they decided which college I was going to go to. And it was like, everyone was just making decisions for me. But when I got pregnant, it was the first time that I probably in my life that I was like, no, I'm going to make the decisions for myself. Like nobody gets a say in this, because it was my body and my life. And now I was, you know, all of a sudden an adult, or at least I thought I was. So
did that life change affect also how you went after your health symptoms, like making the changes, you know, to take action for your own life purpose and your direction? Did that
it did
also
not.
Change?
Yeah. No, oh, okay. It did not. I will tell you, because what happened was, which this is happens all the time, is that if you, like, once my migraines went away, I was kind of just like, and I started making my own decisions, I was kind of like, I'm good. Like, I'm set here. This is the life I thought I wanted. And I continued on with life. I ended up getting married to, he had been like my high school sweetheart. We had been together for 3 years when I got pregnant. And I went on to have three total, adding an extra child in there. And when yeah. I was like 26, I had had my third child. She was one. I started feeling terrible again, like horrible. And nobody could tell me what it was. Like nobody could tell me. I had been right at 26, I'd been diagnosed with cancer. I started to feel terrible and I went to the doctor and I was diagnosed with cancer. So they knew what that was. I had melanoma, stage 2 melanoma, and it was in several parts of my body, had surgery, and it really shook me. I'm 26 years old. I have three children and I'm diagnosed with cancer. It really, and this is a cancer. If you let it get past a certain point, there's no cure for it. Thank goodness it didn't get that far, but after I'd had all my surgeries, about a year later, I started feeling terrible again, like horrible. It was like this repeating cycle. And it wasn't that I had migraines. I started having like heart palpitations. I would wake up at night just sweating. There were times I'd wake up at night feeling so sick and sweating so bad that if I got out of bed, I would literally like pass out. I was shaking. All of these like crazy things were happening. They brought me in, they did all of these tests. Like they were worried my melanoma had spread someplace. It had not. They couldn't find anything. They hooked me up to a heart machine and nothing, literally nothing. And I was so, so sick. I felt terrible. My migraines had actually come back, not as bad. They weren't daily. It was almost like I was having panic attacks, but the way that the doctors describe panic attacks, it wasn't what I was feeling, but it was like every single day, I had ridiculously low blood pressure. It was just terrible, terrible. And I went from doctor to doctor to doctor and everyone was like, you're fine. Like we don't see anything wrong with you.
You're fine. According to what they were taking like blood tests or what were they doing to get to the place of you're fine?
I had blood tests. I had CAT scans. I had chest x-rays. I had MRIs. Wow. I had a stress test. Like at one point the woman's like, get off of the treadmill. We're never going to get your heart rate up, Pat. You're fine. I wore a heart monitor so I could, and I'm 27, almost 28 years old, in ridiculously good shape. And there literally, if you look at me, there's nothing wrong, but there was something so wrong, but nobody would, they like couldn't tell me what it is. Like I wore heart monitors. So when my heart started doing this palpitation, mm-hmm. it would do this really weird thing. I could press the button so it would record it. It literally was recording nothing, like nothing was wrong. Even though it was having episodes.
So you, how would you feel it experience it wise and not have it show up on a test? I mean, that's really weird. So what was the experience?
It was weird, but what I realized was that, again, I was in my life living a life that I didn't want to live. Mm, mm-hmm. Like, I was married. I was a stay-at-home mom. I had three amazing children, and I was the most miserable I have ever been in my life with my own choices. You know what I mean? Like, there's been some terrible things that have happened in my life, but this was, like, my own choice, and I was choosing to stay in a relationship that was, it was pretty bad. It was pretty bad. And my body was like rejecting it. It was rejecting everything that I was doing in my life and everything that was going on and the place and the situation I had gotten myself into. Like my soul was out of alignment. for lack of a better word, my soul was out of alignment.
Wow. To come to that place. So what made you realize you were out of alignment and make a decision to get out into alignment?
Yeah. And I think the big eye opener in was my cancer, because I knew then that I was miserable. I even said, the doctor said to me, there's really no logical reason why you have melanoma. Nobody in my family had any form of skin cancer. I'm not a sun worshiper. I didn't go to tanning beds. I don't even tan. And so it was really like the way the doctors approached it, which I guess was really good for me, was that we don't know why you have it. It's just something your body specifically produced, kind of thing. So that made me start thinking, okay, if there's no medical reason why I have this, it has to be something I'm doing. And I took full responsibility. Like, I truly believe, and I know people don't always like to hear this, but I really do truly believe that we get cancer because we kind of give it to ourselves, because of being out of alignment with ourselves, being miserable, not taking action, not being aware of how we're feeling, not, you know, looking at the energy. Like, disease in the body is dis-ease in the body, which means your energy is out of alignment with where it needs to be. And I do truly own that. But I knew what I needed to do, but I was too afraid to do it. So my body again revolted. And that's when I was having all of those things. And I just decided, like, this is crazy. There's no medical reason. So I'm not medically sick. And that's what I told myself. If I was really at that point where if a doctor can't tell me what's wrong, then I'm not medically sick. So what other way am I sick? And I started to really assess, like, well, where am I not happy? Where am I miserable? Where am I making choices that are out of alignment with what I truly want? Where am I trying to people please? Where do I feel disempowered? Where do I feel like I'm stuck and trapped in my own life? And I don't have to be. I can make any decision and choice that I want to.
Wow. And that's one, taking charge of and ownership for your experience and not trying to put it outside of yourself. Right. That's different than what we're taught to do. So, I mean, and from this, there's that transition period where now you're making the changes and moving into the work that you offer now. So tell us more about that journey and what you're doing.
So fast forward a couple of years, I finally took action. I got divorced. It was very uncomfortable and scary because I'd been a stay-at-home mom. I had had side businesses and stuff like that, but now I was on my own with three small children. And my son actually started to get very, very sick. His body started attacking his eyes. And this was all like, he got sick probably 6 months after I did, after I realized like I had to make a change. And I think it was in the process of making the change. And his body started attacking his eyes. So he was going blind. And it had been like a long journey of a lot of things. I took him to so many doctors. Nobody could tell me why. They just could tell me what was happening. And they put him on multiple steroids. He had injections, like steroid injections in his eyes. Within a year and a half to 2 years, he ended up having to have an implant put in one of his eyes because the disease was really, really attacking the eye and causing blindness. And this was the only way to kind of correct some of his vision, was to put an implant in. And during that process, I was going through a divorce. And I look at other people's divorces, and in the moment, it felt terrible. It felt like it was overwhelming, but in reality, it was a fairly smooth divorce, but it was a hard transition still. Whenever you end something that was going on for 11 years or 10 years and you know, there's children involved, it's a very sensitive thing. But we ended up getting really good. And we ended up, you know, to the point where my son's disease kind of went dormant, even though he was still taking medicine and he was put on, you know, chemotherapy medicine to suppress his immune system. And I ended up getting into another relationship and falling in love, and I was happy. I felt amazing. Everything was so great. Still in the back of my mind, I was like, okay, why are these things kind of happening to us, but nobody can medically tell us. Right. But like, I ignored them. And for a couple of years, like, life was wonderful. I was working, worked in that corporate job, running, multi-million dollar businesses. And then in 2014, I started to feel, late 2013, early 2014, I started to feel like something was very wrong, very, very wrong. And in February 2014, I woke up one morning and my fiance at the time had a heart attack and had died. And let me tell you, my entire world came crashing down, like everything, like my body started shutting down on me. My emotions, like I didn't want to live anymore. It was the darkest time in my entire life, but not just for me, but for my children as well. It was so hard. It was like everything we had ever planned to do, the universe had taken it, ripped it away from me and said, here, start over. And figure it out, like right from the, you have nothing left. Because not only did my fiance pass away, 2 weeks later, 2.5 weeks later, my grandmother passed away. And within 7 months, I had been fired from my job because I refused to do some unethical things. And I literally was sitting there with nothing. And not only was it just like, all this crazy stuff had happened to me, but within a month of Mike, my fiance, passing, my son's disease came back. He ended up in the hospital with panic attacks. And I knew that this wasn't medical. It was like straight in my face that these things that are happening to our bodies are because of our souls. They're because of our emotions. They're because of our, our disconnect. They're because of the tragedies that we're experiencing in life, no matter how severe or how minor the tragedy might look to somebody else, that when we are out of alignment or facing things that are truly horrific in our life. And again, horrific is personal. It's, sometimes horrific can be, car accident where you walk away physically undamaged, but mentally it's a bad place, or somebody dying or somebody being abused or losing a job or going through a divorce. Like there's so many different things. But what I realized was that what we experience in life has a direct correlation with our physical health. And that so many times the doctors can't give us explanations as to why something happens, or it just doesn't sit right, because it's not a medical thing. It's a soul thing. It's an energy thing. It's a body thing. And that set me on this journey to, uncover into not just, really embrace my psychic gifts. And that's when I learned of my really started acknowledging my psychic gifts was when Mike died, because I wanted to know that he was still there, that he didn't just leave me. He didn't just disappear. And it brought me into this really deeper understanding of energy and the soul and the body and why we have certain reactions, physical reactions inside of our body when we're experiencing something outside, something in the physical world.
That is quite a journey.
Yeah.
Go through all of that. So when, and I have this temptation to want to jump right to this place where now you're developing this psychic gift and reaching out for connection again. What did you find?
Well, I was at that place when Mike died. I was at the place that I didn't know what I believed in. I had been raised congregational. It's a Christian religion, but it's not in your face. So like, yes, I believed in God, but I didn't know if I really like believed in God. Like, was there somebody sitting up there watching over us and helping us? And so I really had no faith, nothing. And even I remember after Mike died, just feeling like I was being punished. Like I'd made bad choices in life or something happened. And I needed to kind of rectify that, because I was at a point where it would have been terrible. Like at one point, I think I must have said something really bad to my mom, because my mom was like, she got the impression that I was going to kill myself, basically. And so on this journey, I realized that like people don't just disappear. It helped me to understand energy at an entirely different level. Like we all know the law of attraction, but that's literally just skimming the surface of energy. Mm-hmm. And so I was able to start connecting with energy. I could hear people talk. I could see beings, but I had my whole life. I could see things that happen in the future, but now I was really starting to understand how to work with energy and manipulate energy and use energy for healing purposes and being able to feel different energies. And it really opened up this entirely new world of not just communicating, because, you know, communicating with guides is for me, it's simple, but this whole other idea of working with energy to heal the physical body became so very important to me because I was feeling terrible. I was absolutely having panic attacks. I was feeling horrible. I'd lost so much weight that I'm a tiny person to begin with, but size 00 was like falling off of me. And here's my son, mentally, emotionally, and physically like falling apart because of my fiance's death and just not being able to handle what was going on. So I started to realize the power that we had to work with energy and to change the way that we were living our life. And those changes were hard, very hard to say the least. And I'm well aware of that when I'm like, oh, we've got to make changes to your life. You've got to change the way you think about things. I remember something really powerful. I went to see a shaman. Actually, it was on Mike's birthday, 2 months after he died. And I was really nervous about my son, which I had never really been nervous about before, but he had a couple of years back, he had choked on a donut in the car. And it was terrifying. Like he was turning blue. He ended up getting it out just as I was pulling over. And he was like, I don't know, 7 years old. It wasn't like he was little. I'd given a 2-year-old a donut or something. And from that moment on, he had been afraid to chew things, like always afraid he was going to choke. And after Mike died, I started having panic attacks that he would be home because he was a little bit older. And if I ran to the store, he'd stay home by himself and play video games. I was terrified. I just kept seeing him in my head choking and dying. And I'm a seer and I've seen all drastic things that I saw that I had cancer before, years before I did. I saw my dying before he did. I saw my parents divorce. I saw so many things in my life. So this scared me that I could see this. And when I went to the shaman, she said to me, I don't see this for your son, but what I see is every single time you think of it, you're carving a path. You're carving a path, and that path gets deeper and deeper, and it creates like a river for energy or to flow down, just as if water would. She said, you must change the thought because wherever we put our thoughts, we create these pathways for energy to flow. Right. And it literally creates an opportunity or a potential for whatever it is that we're focusing on to become reality. And when she said that to me, I was like, I didn't think about him dying or choking again, because I could see how powerful energy was and what I was doing with it and how I was being affected by it. So I really started to embrace what we as humans, as spirits, you know, spiritual beings in a human body have the ability to do with energy to change not just our life and our thoughts and, you know, the energy around us, but change our physical body, really start changing that.
This is a beautiful moment right here where you're describing the magic inside of law of attraction. You know, you said many people skim it. Well, this is the work. It is really paying attention to the thoughts that start on one side of the brain and make its way over to the other side unchecked. And I think this was the gift that the shaman gave you, and what a beautiful perspective. So what did you do with that information? Because it sounds like this is the prelude to your business.
Yeah, it was. So I actually have two aspects of my business. I do psychic channeling for entrepreneurs and for people, but one of the most powerful things that I do, even inside the entrepreneur world, is I help people to heal their souls. I'm a truth seer, so I can see what's happened to your soul in past lives, in this life, things that have happened in the womb space when you're super little. I can also see what's going to happen to you. I read karmic energy. I can see contracts, all that kind of stuff. So what I realized was that there's so many factors that are affecting the body. And I went on it. This wasn't just like one morning I woke up and I was like, wow, look at all this. It's like a long journey. So I spent about 18 months after I left my job trying to build my business, but really embracing all of the information I could find and download about energy, about the human body, about the spirit, about the potential that we all hold. And this is, we all hold it. Every single one of us has it. And I did 18 months of intense channeling. So most of my information, everyone's like, did you read this book? I'm like, no, I don't know anybody. And I haven't read any books because all the information I got has been from my guides. I'm a very intensive channeler. And they started to show me that if we can heal every aspect of the body, the mental, the emotional, the physical, the spiritual, then what happens is that we can begin to heal our physical bodies. And I started very slowly on different things. Like I, you know, my son had had panic attacks and he's been like my biggest, I guess, guinea pig. And he's so great about it, but he had been having panic attacks. And the doctor said to me, a psychiatrist said, we hospitalize him or you put him on medication. And I was like, put him on medication. And I ended up working with him by myself. He wouldn't speak to a therapist. He's very shy. He wouldn't talk to a therapist. So I spent a solid 6 months. I did not want my son on medication. I'm not a big medication person. I never have been. And so after 6 months of intense, like him and I working together, I brought him back to a therapist. They monitored him for a month, of like just talking to him and stuff. And we took him 100% off of his, he was on, anti-anxiety medicine. Then his autoimmune disorder, which they don't know what it is, but his body started attacking his eyes again in that process. And they were talking about more surgeries. We were doing more things. And about 3 years ago, 3 or 4 years ago, they told me that they wanted to go in and his body was now attacking his good eye and that they wanted to go in and do surgery. And at that point, I had been really deep in helping people to heal, helping myself to heal with like the mental, the emotional, the physical, the spiritual, going into all aspects. And I said to the doctor, no, like I said, I don't want to do this again. I don't want to do surgery. You can't tell me why it's happening. And the surgery is, I think this will help. And I said, I can't let you cut into his only eye that's still good because you think something will help. So I asked him, how much time do I have before he goes blind? Because it's the leading cause of blindness in children. And he said to me, if you let me put a steroid injection in his eye, and I think he was 14 at the time. Yeah, he just turned 14. And he looked at my son and he'd been my son's doctor since he was six for this illness. And he's like, bud, you'll sit and let me put a needle in your eye. And my son just looked at me and looked at him and said, shrugged his shoulders and said, okay. And I just was like, oh my God, I can't do this to my kid anymore. So he said, you have 3 months. And I said, okay, thank you. And he said, but you need to come back after 3 months. I didn't go back till 3.5 years. And I spent those 3.5 years healing my son. We did everything that I knew how to do, from emotional stuff, mental stuff, physical stuff. I did energy healing on him. We did past life stuff. And the interesting thing with children is that so much of it is connected to their parents. So there was relationships in past lives between him and I that had to be healed and fixed, and karmic energy had to be broken. The soul had to be realigned. I had to do actual physical healing on his eye to remove things from his eye. And when I took him back to the doctor, and every time I'd say to him, how's your vision? Like, did it change? I wasn't just oblivious. I didn't just ignore what was going on. I was very well aware, and I would tune in with my guides, ask my guides. They kept telling me he was fine. So I took him back to the doctor after 3.5 years, just this past August. And he was like, God, it's been so long since I saw you. And you could tell he was so nervous. And he did his exam and he was super quiet. They did all the tests that they always do. And the doctor looked at me, he's like, it's been 3.5 years. And I said, I know. I just sat there and he's like, I don't know what you did. He said, but there is not a stitch of disease in this kid. His eye is 20/20 vision in that one eye. The bad eye had not gotten any worse. And there was not one single sign of him ever being sick, aside from like the surgery that the doctor had already done because of his bad eye.
Amazing testament. Yeah,
it is. And he said, you know, whatever you're doing, keep doing it. He said, I will see you in 2 years unless Noah recognizes some signs. And he's 17, so he's pretty well aware. And I was so nervous going in there, but my guides kept saying, he's fine, he's fine. And it was so powerful to know that this disease has never been healed by healing, ever. He has uveitis is what it's called. And the doctor cannot explain what happened, but all I know is the stuff that I do, it works. If we heal our souls, if we heal our emotional body, if we heal our mental body, if we work to heal our physical body and the energetic body that lies inside of us, we can heal anything. And I truly believe that. I've worked with people with Alzheimer's. I've worked with people with cancer. I work on a little boy right now who's got a brain tumor. I've worked with broken bones before, pulled shoulders, tendons that are, ripped, muscles, everything is healable with energy. And it's interesting because my children are very involved in this. And my daughter, we were driving the other day and she said, "Ma, do you think you could grow somebody's leg back from energy?" And I was like, "I don't actually know.
Let's try.
I know. Love to try." Yeah.
I've had that question posed to me before too. And I say that too. I'm like, if you give your body what it needs, it'll heal itself. It goes on to a journey. And I was asked that question. "Well, if I cut off my arm, will you be able to grow it back?" Well, I think that's up to the person. So let's have an experiment, shall we? No, don't.
But you're so right. I can only do my part.
Right.
If the individual on the other side, like if I'm healing you and you're closed and you're not receptive, I can heal your shoulder. Like, let's say you have a pain in your shoulder. I can heal the pain in your shoulder. So you feel amazing, but you'll be back in a week because we're not healing the underlying problem. Right. And that's what you must get to, but you have to be an active participant in the healing process. It's not magic in the sense that I wave my magic wand. It's magic in the sense that if we just do the work we need to do, we can heal anything in the physical body. I truly believe this. Like I didn't allow my son to have surgery. I risked him going blind because I completely believe in this. And with myself too, like something I've wholeheartedly subscribe to. And I feel that anybody who's out of alignment, whether you're building a business, this is the first step. If something's not going correctly in your life and you feel junky, you feel tired, you feel overwhelmed, you have a chronic, shoulder pain or a autoimmune disorder, fibromyalgia, all of those things can be healed by healing yourself. The medicine is a Band-Aid. To me, the medicine's a Band-Aid. It just covers the symptoms.
Even just a short-term symptom that can help you get to the next step, it's great. So as folks are listening to you and they resonate with this concept, which I believe in it too, how can they interact with you? What's the best way they can reach out?
Yeah, so I have a private Facebook group. It's free. It's completely free. It's called the Affluent Entrepreneur. We do a lot of entrepreneur things, but I do a lot of healing because I do believe that the foundation of anything you do in your life is healing. So if you're going to build a business, you must heal. If you're going to open your psychic abilities, which I teach people how to heal as well. And if somebody's interested in learning how to heal, I have an academy that I actually teach people how to be healers on all levels. Any level of energy that people want, any modality, I can teach them all and I do them all. So it's on Facebook. It's called Affluent Entrepreneur, or you can follow me on Instagram. It's Carrie Cardozo.
Very good. I'm going to, I think I'm a member of Affluent Entrepreneur. If I'm not, I'll double check and make sure I am, because this is my world too, using the psychic ability to help heal. So beautiful. Thank you for that, for sharing. And I always wrap up the whole show with this final question. What do you feel is the most important thing to remember when searching for answers?
That you have all of the information inside of you.
Yes.
I'm a psychic and I give people information every day, but I would much rather teach you how to access the information inside of you than be your lifelong psychic. No matter what it is, whether our bodies are not supporting us, whether we need to make a decision in our life, whether we're building a business, whether we're questioning who we really are, every single thing you could possibly need is already inside of you. Your job is to reconnect, to uncover what it is.
Oh, beautiful. That is the work, isn't it? Well, thank you so much, Carrie, for being on the show. I truly appreciate you and your time.
Thank you for having me. It's been fun.
Yeah, good. So thank you, listeners, for being out there and listening to When Doctors Say We Don't Know. This has been another engaging conversation, and I'm hopeful that those of you listening will hear that message of hope so that you too can turn your experience of pain into triumph. If you're driving and can't click on the links or just simply can't do it right now for whatever reason, the show notes with Carrie's information will be in our page. Whatever your favorite listening podcast, where you're hearing us today, or you can go to theelevateinstitute.com and follow the podcast links for today's show. There's more to talk about. Tune in next week for the next episode of When Doctors Say We Don't Know. This is Eva Venari reminding you to question everything.